Good morning. Happy Sabbath. It is wonderful to be able to be worshiping together here at the Monterey Bay Academy SDA Church. The whole world paused this morning. Do you know why? Because an eight-year-old's tank was empty. The boys had already started their school day at their desks, and I was preparing to leave for work when I noticed my littlest standing in the bathroom wiping his face. I paused at the door and asked if he was okay. He looked up with tears, silently dripping, and shook his head. When I questioned if something happened, again, he shook his head. So I sat on the side of the tub and pulled him in my lap. I told him sometimes our heart tanks feel empty and need to be refilled. He cried into my chest and I held tight. I asked if he could feel my love filling him up. A nod and tears stopped. I waited a minute. Has it reached your toes yet? He shook his head no. Okay, man, we will take as long as you need. Work doesn't matter right now. School isn't important either. This right here is the most important thing today. Filling you back to the top. Is that good? He nods. One more minute. Is your heart full of mama's love now? Yeah. Looks in his eyes, I see it shining in there. You're full to the top and you're smiling. Each one of us, you may not be eight, you may be 28, 38, 48, or continue on, but all of us run on empty just like he did. His weekend was so busy and so full, his little soul was just dry. So we all have to take time to pause and to take a moment to refill with the good things. Scripture, prayer, sunshine, worship, song, laughter, friends, hugs, whatever it takes to refill your empty, or you'll find those emotions like tears, anger, snappy words, overflowing with no reason why. Take a moment today, refill. It's the most important part of your day. And so I hope and pray that today, as you worship together with us, that your heart will be refilled. And as we move into this new school year that's about to begin, that you will make sure that each week you're taking time and each day to refill your heart so that you can pour into those students that will be in front of you. Welcome again, and it's good to see faces and visitors and new people that have arrived, new staff, new volunteers, students. I know that there are international students that have arrived on campus and a lot arriving tomorrow, and so just look forward to the pews being full again. At this time, our offering today is for local church budget, and there's a tray at the back on the welcome stand there, and so you can leave your offerings there. Also know that you can give through Adventist Giving. If you got the newsletter, you know that we also have effort that is being placed to support Hawaiian Mission Academy Maui, the school there, to help support them. Thankfully, their school is standing, but they've had about 10 new students that are going to be joining them this year because of displacement. And so we're raising funds to help support the tuition dollars there for them. All right, at this time, we'll have our scripture and prayer.
Today's scripture reading is found in Psalms 37:4. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart.
Please join me for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to worship together this Sabbath and for all your blessings this past week. Thank you for this new school year and for the students that have already arrived back on campus. Thank you so much for the teachers that have put so much hard work into planning for this upcoming year, and please help them to feel prepared. Please be with the people in Maui as they recover from the terrible fires and the people in Southern California as they prepare for an unusually powerful storm. We pray for those present today that may be experiencing challenges and ask for courage and strength for each and every one of them. Please bless our speaker today and help us to be receptive to the message he brings us. Please guide our lives and help us to become more like you. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The world has had its great teachers, men and women of giant intellect, and the extensive research, men whose utterances have stimulated thought and opened to vast fields of knowledge, and these men have been honored as guides and benefactors of their race.
But there is one who stands higher than they,
We can trace the line of the world's teachers as far back as human records extend. What then is a teacher, a servant, a missionary for God, an instructor, an educator, a coach, a professor, a mentor, a schoolmaster, an advisor, a counselor?
A shadow of the divine.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was the God, he was with God in the beginning. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. To all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God.
How is this done? How is this possible?
The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known.
What then is a teacher?
A teacher is, first of all, a student of the light, of the Word made flesh, a student of Christ, the greatest teacher planet Earth has ever experienced.
He is our model, our master teacher, revealed to us 2,000 years ago when a carpenter began to teach. He taught as one who had authority.
Jesus went around teaching from village to village. Jesus instructed his disciples. He went to teach and preach in the towns and open fields. Jesus taught by the lake. He taught by parable. He taught by lecture. He taught by example. He taught by asking questions. He taught by being silent.
Jesus was always teaching, always guiding. The world was his classroom.
In every person, he saw infinite possibilities. He saw men as they might be, transfigured by his grace in the beauty of the Lord. Looking upon them with hope, he inspired hope. Meeting them with confidence, he inspired trust.
Christ, the master teacher, instills in us, his students, an unquenchable thirst to learn, to know, to give, to grow, to live, to love, to use the gifts he has given us.
True education means more than the perusal of a certain course of study. It means more than a preparation for the life that now is.
For every human, created in the image of God, is endowed with power akin to that of the Creator.
Individuality.
Power to think and to do. It is our work as teachers to develop these powers, to train the youth to be thinkers, not mere reflectors of other men's thoughts.
He who cooperates with the divine purpose in imparting to the youth a knowledge of God does a high and noble work. A teacher, then, is not only a student of Christ, but a co-worker with him as well. Who, then, is a teacher?
Anyone who is a student of Christ. We go then into the classrooms, into the playground, into the fields, into the dorms, into every nook and corner of life to teach.
To teach the obstinate, to guide the confused, to love the unlovely, to care for the broken, to lift up the weak, to comfort the hurting, to spread the light of God to every child we meet.
And so we follow. Amen. Amen.
At this time, I would like you to stand if you're going to be a student this year, if you're going to be a teacher this year at any school. So if you're a student, yep, keep standing. If you're going to be a support staff person at school this year, if you're going to be an administrator at a school, and if you're going to be a parent of a child that will be in school somewhere. Please bow your heads with me as we have a dedication prayer. Dear God, as a new school year begins, we come before you with a heart full of hopes and prayers for all, as we ask for your guidance, protection, wisdom to accompany every single person on this journey. I ask that you grant them the strength to face challenges and the resilience to overcome obstacles. Help them make meaningful connections with friends who uplift their spirits and encourage their growth. We pray for our students. Lord, I pray that teachers everywhere will make a lasting impact on the students, families, and communities that they interact with. Lord, I also want to ask you to watch over the staff at the schools. I pray for them to be encouraged as what they take care of makes the whole school work for the teachers and students. Without them at the school, things at the school would not run smoothly. So I pray for them to be blessed in their daily lives. Lord, I want to lift up our school administrators. I pray that you strengthen them each day as they seek to lead. I pray you guide them as they make hard decisions, and I pray that you encourage them. And I lift up to you all the parents that will be sending their children to spend each day of school, at school, in the hands and in the impacted by the lives of the teachers that are in the rooms with them. Encourage them. And Lord, help us as a church to provide the support that's needed. May this school year be a time of growth, discovery, and meaningful experiences. And in your name, we lift up all students, all teachers, all parents, all staff, all administrators, and all church members, trusting that you will walk alongside each one of us every step of the way this year. Amen.
All right, good morning, everyone. I don't know about you, but I have been blessed so far with the music, the beautiful consecration, and also the kids participating with the reading of the scripture. So it's beautiful to see everyone involved. And although we are a small group here today, I feel like I'm in a good family, and I'm happy to be here with you today. And this morning, I don't know if you had breakfast, but I had a very good one. My wife made some Brazilian cheese bread. If you don't know what that is, you're missing a lot. And we invited Kezia and Maria, she's a new volunteer here at MBA, to come and have some of those with us. And they had a blast. Maria never tried one of those, so she said she wanna move to Brazil now. Is that right, Maria? But anyway, it was really good, and we had a good meal together, and that was a great way to start the Sabbath. And the reason why I bring this up is because the title for the sermon today is Where to Find Permanent Satisfaction. And when we have a meal, when the meal is good, I don't know about you, but I feel very satisfied. I'm still feeling satisfied too much right now, but we feel satisfied. And the text that I chose for this message is Psalm 37, verse 4, which basically says how we can find dissatisfaction and where we can find it. And in the New Living Translation, David says, "Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you your heart's desires," which means seek God, get to know him, and you're going to feel satisfied. You're going to find the desires of your heart. So I'd like to explore this text today with you, and I'd like to propose to you the main point of today's sermon, which is this. When we take time to meditate on God, that will lead us to discover how great he is. And that will lead us to worship him. And that will bring us permanent satisfaction. So that's the theme that we're going to go through the sermon today. And I'd like to break this down as we go together here right now. But before I do, I'd like to have prayer with you once more, asking the Holy Spirit to be with us in this moment so we can really understand the message that God has for us. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, here we are in this place, in this church, with our brothers and sisters in this Sabbath day, and we are glad because we have the opportunity to be here and to worship you, our Creator, our Redeemer, the one who has blessed us with life and health and all the good things, including the food we had this morning. And I pray, Father, that as we now listen to this message, that you speak to our hearts, help us to change what we need to change so we can come close to you. And that way we can enjoy the full and permanent satisfaction that you made us to enjoy. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Very well. So I'd like to begin the message exploring the problem that we face nowadays, which is our human tendency to seek satisfaction in things that God created. So we either tend to seek satisfaction in humans or things built, invented, created by human beings. So when we seek satisfaction in humans, I'm talking about, for example, relationships. Maybe some of you here today think, well, if I get married, then I will be satisfied. Or maybe you're thinking, well, if I have a friend or friends, then I will feel fulfilled. And then you rely your satisfaction on a person, on a being created by God. On the other side, you can go and say that to be satisfied, you need to have something that was created by a human being. And let me give you two examples. A couple weeks ago or months ago now, I saw the launching of the Apple Vision Pro. So those of you who are into technology know how exciting that device is. Those of you who don't, I'll try to make it exciting for you, okay? But it's something revolutionary. The same way that computers were revolutionary when they were invented, and cell phones were revolutionary, this device will combine a computer, a cell phone, and put you on your face as an eyeglass, and then you can do all the things you do usually with your computer and cell phone, now using your eyes, your voice, and gestures. And you can see all this happening right in front of you in the space where you actually are. So if that was not convincing enough and to make you excited, you can go later on YouTube and try to watch the clip that they put together for this device. But it's really something unique that actually will revolutionize, again, technology. And when I saw that, I was so excited. I was telling my wife, man, when these things comes out, I'm going to get one. They are selling for $3,500. I'm not excited about that part, but it's really, really interesting. And then the second great thing that excited me lately was something that all of you are aware right now, ChatGPT. Man, what is that? The whole knowledge in the world that is available online, now it's available to you through this artificial intelligence feature that you can ask questions, get answers, bring problems, it will bring you solutions. And it's something that a lot of people are talking about nowadays, about the pros and the cons. But when I heard about it first time, I was so excited about it though. I thought that was incredible. And then when I stopped for a moment to think about my reaction to these two inventions, I realized that I was so amazed by something invented by man who was created by God. So my point is that I have been so excited lately for things created by man, but I realized that my excitement for the Creator God was not as much as for the things created by the creations of God. I think you're understanding my point here. So that's the problem. Sometimes, or a lot of times, we focus and we give a lot of our attention to things created by God and their creations, and not so much to God Himself. And the problem with that is that we think that we're going to find satisfaction in those things created by God. And sometimes we do. When you get married, maybe you're excited. Honeymoon, things are going well. And then after you're back from honeymoon, well, things are not doing that well anymore, right? Or maybe when you get something new, a new device, you get excited about it for a while, and then later the excitement is gone. Or maybe something else happened and that excitement goes away. So what I'm trying to say is that the things that we think we can find satisfaction, they bring maybe for a while, but eventually they are gone. Because the creations that human creates, and even humans themselves, we, are limited, are finite. And that's why sometimes we get into a cycle of looking for the next thing. This Apple Vision Pro is amazing right now, but 5 years from now, it's gonna be outdated. Whatever is exciting you today, in a little while, it's not gonna be as exciting anymore. And then what happens? We're gonna go into the next thing. And then we're gonna go into the next thing, always searching for that satisfaction. And then when we don't have it, then we're not satisfied. Then we are depressed, then we're sad because we don't have what we want or we don't have that thing that brings us satisfaction. So that's our problem. Things that God created, human beings, and things that human beings create, they cannot bring us full satisfaction and complete satisfaction. Relationships, as good as they can be, eventually you can be hurt by someone you love. Maybe you think I'm gonna help other people and that will bring me satisfaction, and then that person that you helped eventually also bring you disappointment, and then you're not satisfied anymore. Or maybe you think I'm gonna grow myself, I'm gonna get educated, I'm gonna get fit, and then eventually that becomes an obsession of yours, and then you neglect other parts of your life, and again you find yourself miserable because that was not enough to bring satisfaction. And people say, well, if you have money and possessions, that will make you happy. All of everybody knows that that's not the case. And those that are rich, guess what? They are constantly worrying and fearing that something's gonna happen to their money. And they are not satisfied as well. Human achievements, all these things, they may bring satisfaction for a moment, but eventually they go away and then we lose that satisfaction. So that's the problem. And then the question is, what's the solution then? How can we find this permanent satisfaction? How can we live our lives in a way that we are always satisfied? Regardless of what happens around us, regardless of the things that we have or don't have in our lives. So the answer to this question is in the Bible. And that's the text that we chose for today. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you your heart's desire. That's the solution. If you want to experience permanent satisfaction, we have to seek God, and only through Him we're going to feel the satisfaction. But how does that actually happen? So let me break that down for you. First step, we need to meditate on God. And the word meditate means to be absorbed in thought, to fill our minds with it. And the Hebrew word actually for meditate is the word haga, which means to mutter, to murmur. And when I read this, I remember Daniel. When he walks on the highway of the school, sometimes I see him thinking about a lot of things and he's talking to himself because he's absorbed with something that he has to do. So that's kind of a meditation. You have something in your mind that is completely filling your brain, and then you let that out. You're speaking to yourself. Another word that also the Bible uses for meditation is the word in Greek, meletao, which means to revolve in the mind. So you have something, and then you think about that something over and over again. You think about that something in different aspects. You think about that something in different facets. You contemplate that something for a long period of time. That's what meditation is. And we usually do that when we are going to make decisions. For example, students that are here today, when you were told that you would come to MBA, maybe some of you were debating. Well, should I go? Should I not go? What are the pros? What are the cons? Will it be a good school for me? Or maybe I can find a better school somewhere else. Maybe that was your meditation moment where you were thinking about this topic. Another example that I can give you is when my wife decided to date me. That was a hard decision. I'm telling why. She was looking at the time for someone that would be taller than her, mark that one on the check, that would have light eyes, mine is not light blue or light green, but it's light, and that will have curly hair, then mine is curly, it is not, doesn't show what it is. And then she always, of course, wanted somebody who was a Christian, but she wanted a pastor as well. I was not a pastor at the time, I was not planning to, but eventually I became a pastor, I got my license, so that one also was checked. But the problem is that at that time when she met me, I was 17 years old, she was 20, and I was the poorest guy that you could find around at that time, and I had this tooth broken in half. So come on ladies, would you give a chance to that guy? So she did. So that was her meditation moment, thinking about all these different aspects of this man that she was planning to date and eventually marry. And the point that I'm trying to make here is this, that when we talk about meditation, involves this concentration. The same way we concentrate to make a decision, an important decision, we evaluate many different aspects, the good, the bad, the ups and downs of that decision, and then finally we make that decision. In the same way, we need to meditate about God. Who is this God? How is he like? What are the benefits of following him? What can he offer to me? And then when you try to explore and meditate on God, you're going to find amazing things. First of all, you find out that God is love, that God is the definition of love. There are a lot of people that, for example, they are associated with a word. For example, when you think about kindness, who comes to your mind? Somebody kind. Some people think of Mother Teresa, right? Some people think of Princess Diana. When you think about somebody, when you think about the word strength, who comes to your mind? The Rock, Arnold Schwarzenegger, I don't know how to pronounce his last name. Our former governor, right? When you think about beauty, who comes to your mind? My wife, okay, just to make clear here. But none of these are the definition of the word. So Mother Teresa, she was kind, but she's not kindness. The Rock, he's strong, but he's not strength. Whoever you can think of to be pretty, the person is pretty, but it's not beauty itself. But that's different with God. God, he is love. And because he is love, there are two things. He can be the source of love, and he also can only act, speak in love. So when we come close to him, we become loving. When we get ourselves away from him, we become selfish. It's the consequence. So the reason why this is important is because when we start to meditate in God, on God, we realize that he is this loving being. And not only that, but he also acts in loving ways towards us. The Bible says many, many times in many different ways how God loves each one of us. One that I like a lot is in Romans 5:8, where it says, "But God demonstrates his own love towards us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." That's the kind of love that he has for us. And then when we start exploring that idea of this loving God, and we actually give the time to be immersed in thinking of him and what he is, who he is, what he does, what he says, there is a natural process that happens in our hearts where we start to realize how great is this God that we serve. And when we realize how great this God is, then we also naturally go to the next step, which is to praise this amazing God. And when we think about somebody great, maybe you can think of somebody who is great in technology today. I don't know who comes to your mind. Maybe you can think of the Facebook inventor, or maybe Elon Musk with Tesla, or when you think about somebody that is great in music, who comes to your mind? This is everybody here will have a different response for that one. When you think about somebody great in sports, who comes to your mind? And whoever came to your mind, how did you get to the conclusion that that person is the greatest? Well, the answer is that you used comparison. You compare the person that you think to be the best with others, competitors. They are not so good as the one you think is the best. But the thing with God is that God cannot be compared, because in the human level, we have ways to compare one person to another person. But in the divine level, there is no way to compare, because there is just one God. And that's why God is incomparable. And that's why God is the greatest. And that's why when we meditate on Him, when we think of who He is, what He says and what He does, we realize how great is this God. How great is His power, how great is His love, how great is His compassion, His mercy. How amazing is this God. And then, once we are filled with this amazement of this amazing God, guess what happens next? We are led to worship. This is, again, a natural reaction of our being. When we meditate on something, we realize, or someone, that someone is great, we naturally have the tendency to worship that. And let me give an example of what I'm talking about, because we do this all the time as human beings. Last year, there was the Soccer World Cup. I know many of you are not fans of soccer, but this is a Brazilian thing at least, right? We love soccer. And last year, the nation of Argentina won the World Cup, and the best player that they have is called Messi. Maybe you have heard of him, even if you don't know soccer. But Messi is someone that a lot of people say is out of this planet because of his skill playing soccer. It's something that nobody has ever seen, how skillful he is playing the sport. And because he is so amazing, people call him the GOAT, the greatest of all time. And people actually show aspects of worship towards him. And let me share with you what these aspects are. When you worship someone, you show respect and admiration to that someone. So when you show respect, you speak with respect with that person. You show submission, you show obedience, you show appreciation. When you show admiration to someone, you usually express your admiration with praises, with compliments, or with offerings, with gifts, or even with adoration. And I'm just telling you these things because all of these things happens with those who love soccer and love Messi. And let me give an example here. Messi, when he was now out of a club from France, was being requested to play in many different clubs of the world. There was a club in Arabia that offered 1.5 billion euros to have him play for them. That was for him. And he rejected and came to the United States. Also, when he gets into the field, he's always the first to get in front of his teammates, because that's a symbol of his leadership. When he's playing, he commands. He's the leader, and everybody obeys him. Also, when he won the World Cup last year, there were several great names that paid tribute to Messi. One of them was LeBron James, another one was Barack Obama, and they wrote great words praising how talented this soccer player was. Also, Messi has received standing ovations in some games from the opposing team. And that's really rare, because he's so talented that even the opposing team fans, they are so amazed that the only thing they can do is to clap and say how great this player is. He won 7 times the greatest award for a soccer player. And in some games, if you look on YouTube, you see the fans actually bowing down towards this player. So let me ask you, does this sound to you like worship? All these things? Yes, it does. And it is. That's worship. And why the fans do that for this soccer player? Because they meditated on him. How great is this player? They have watched the games. They have spent time seeing the ability and the skill of this player. And now that they see and they experience how great he is, there is the natural reaction of praising, of giving thanks for being so good and so amazing, and giving awards, and that desire to have that person close to you. It's the natural response that we have as human beings to show worship to someone that is great. And in the same way, if we were to take time to spend the same time now with God and realize how great is this God that we have, how amazing he is, all the things he has done, all the things he has said, and how great in all aspects is the God that we serve, there is no way that we're not going to be amazed by him. And when we are amazed by this God, there is no way that we're not going to want to praise him and give him thanks and be so happy to be in his presence. It's the natural human reaction that we have when we are facing someone great. And that's the point that leads us to the last part of the message. When we finally allow ourselves to realize how great God is and worship him and praise him and be thankful for everything that he does, that will bring us satisfaction. And you know why? Because God made us to worship him. And that's the only way that we can fully and permanently have satisfaction in our lives. God made us to be worshipers. And when we worship him, that's when we find permanent satisfaction. And it's permanent because God is eternal and God is complete, different from all the things created by God that are finite and are not complete. So, I'd like to make an appeal to all of us today. And my appeal is this. If we, you and I, have not taken time to actually meditate on God, to spend time with him, so we can find how great is this God. That's my first appeal, that you may take this time to do that. As we begin this new school year here, as students, as teachers, as staff of MBA, I pray that we spend every day the time that we need to be in God's presence and then realize how great he is, so we can worship him and be satisfied as a person. A couple years ago, I was living in Maryland, and there was someone that I worked with that loved Chinese food. And I hated Chinese food, but I never tried Chinese food. But I hated it because in my mind, when I thought of Chinese food, I thought of octopus, raw fish, all those nasty things that just thinking of them made me sick. But this friend of mine would say, no, 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 it's not like that. Come on, come with me. Let's have some Chinese food. I said, no, 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 I'm okay. I'm not going. I don't want to try. And I have to pay for that? No, you're crazy. I'm not going to pay for that. I don't even like it. How do you know? Well, I saw on TV. That's why I don't like it. So he kept insisting with me to go and try over and over. And then one day he said, well, I'm going to make you go because I'm going to pay for you. I said, okay, that makes things different now. All right, you're going to pay. So I think I'm going to try it that way. Because if I don't like it, at least I didn't spend any money on my own. So when I went, we went to a buffet place in town, and then I got into the line and I saw all the variety of different foods, and I was a little skeptical, but I started putting a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and then in the back they had another place that they would make your meat right away for you there, and I'm sorry, I'm not vegetarian, so I was led into temptation there. And then they prepared the food, put it on my plate, and then I went to the table with my friend and I started eating. Oh my goodness. I started eating, and I said, man, this is amazing. This is so good. How in the world I decided not to experience this before? How in the world I was missing out in such a great food? And since that time, I became a Chinese food lover, right? I love other types of food as well, but I love Chinese food. It's interesting because the Bible, when we talk about this aspect of experiencing God and seeing how great He is, uses the metaphor of food. And I just want to close with two verses where Jesus talks about food to illustrate His point that when you actually try it, you're going to see how amazing it is. And this is what Jesus said. He says in John 4:14, but those who drink the water I give will never thirst again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life. And then in John 6:35, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. So what Jesus is saying here is this. Try me. Taste me. And you're going to see how great this meal is. How great my bread and my water is. And when you taste it, you're going to fall in love. And you're going to come over and over again. Like I did with the Chinese restaurant. I was there all the day, every day basically. Because it was so great. But we have to try. A friend took me to that restaurant. And you know that we have a friend who already paid the price for us to try it. His name is Jesus. He paid the price for us to try it. Because He knows how amazing is our God. My appeal for us today is try this God. Try it. Try it. Taste, and you will see how great is our God. And when you experience that, there's no other response than to worship Him and feel satisfied. Amen.
I see the sun.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the time that we spent together here in this place. I pray that you help us to find satisfaction that only can be found in you. Help us, Father, to spend time with you and be amazed by your greatness, and help us also to worship and then find this satisfaction. We pray for these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.